Simon & Schuster Audio presents Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House, by Charlie Spiering. Read by Johnny Heller. Introduction. The place, Washington, D.C. The time, the near future, nearer than you think. Chief of Staff, Jeff Zients. Counselor, Steve Ricchetti. Senior Advisor Mike Donilon and Senior Advisor Anita Dunn gather in the White House to discuss their options with First Lady Jill Biden. Age and infirmity have finally caught up with her husband, despite every effort by family and staff to prop up the aging president. They can no longer hide the truth. President Joe Biden's time in office is over. As they wait for everyone to assemble, they start revisiting how they arrived at this moment. Why did they push for him to run for re-election? Did they really think he could make it another 4 years? The signs of decline were already there. Staffers found him vacant and listless while attempting to brief him ahead of public events. They created note cards. You take your seat. You give brief comments. You depart, the instructions read. The teleprompter speeches grew shorter and simpler, and interactions with the public and even supporters were dialed back. Long stretches of rest were carved out of his schedule, and the press was shut out to limit moments of embarrassment. There was only so much they could do. The frequent coughing could no longer be stifled with a few cough drops. The stiffness grew more apparent as he walked to and from the podium. He lashed out angrily when questioned by the press and appeared lost and confused while aides directed him. The world was watching as the leader of the free world was repeatedly stumbling, falling on the stairs while boarding Air Force One, tipping over on his bicycle and tripping and falling on stage. Why did his trusted circle believe he could do it again? Because they wanted to. He was, after all, the only one who defeated former President Donald Trump. They thought, hoped he could pull it off once more. Biden was passionate about driving Trump and his entire political movement into the dustbin of history. Defeat Trump, defend democracy, and restore the soul of the nation. That was all part of why they pushed the president to keep going. But deep down, they knew the real reason he had to run again. Vice President Kamala Harris was not up to the job. They should have known, they realized, that this was coming. In modern history, many vice presidents have stepped in and taken power suddenly in cases of ill health or national tragedy or near misses. William McKinley's assassination elevated Teddy Roosevelt. Woodrow Wilson had a stroke. Dwight Eisenhower had a heart attack. Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson was sworn in as president just hours after President John F. Kennedy was murdered. Vice President Gerald Ford took office after President Richard Nixon resigned in disgrace. Ronald Reagan came within an inch of losing his life in 1981. Not since President Franklin Delano Roosevelt died at the age of 63 had a president died in office after struggling with health problems, requiring, in FDR's case, Vice President Harry S. Truman to replace him. Truman was ready and experienced. He served as a senator from Missouri for 10 years before he was selected as the vice president, heir apparent to the aging Roosevelt, as Democrats felt confident running him for a historic fourth term. Vice President Kamala Harris's many struggles and mistakes during her first years in office were top of mind. The thin-skinned outrage, perceived grievances around every corner, the staff bullying and endless turnover, the mockery, the refusal to be a team player. A brain stroke away from the presidency, Harris appeared artificial on stage, never willing to engage or risk her brand, and constantly playing defense. Her speeches lacked conviction and spiraled into word salads. Tough questions were answered with laughter and dismissal. Harris barely suppressed her impatience and disdain for the president despite reading platitudes from the teleprompter. After less than 4 years in the Senate, she was not a dealmaker, a consensus builder, or even a conduit to activists. Her presidential campaign, where she launched a bitter but ineffective attack on Biden during one of the debates, was a notorious flop. Instead of playing dutiful backup to the president, Harris was trying to write her own political narrative according to her rules. She was in no position to take over for Biden and lead the Democratic Party into the future. But there was no way the Biden team could replace her on the ticket in 2024. That would be admitting a huge mistake. It's a mistake that cannot be fixed. As Harris prepares to take the oath of office, Biden's aides realize that their power to manipulate their future is gone. They will be forced out of the White House, and President Kamala Harris will take control. Who knows if this scene will play out exactly as described? President Biden may win re-election and serve out a second term with no hiccups, retiring with grace at the age of 86. He may run for re-election and lose, but whatever happens to Biden, Kamala Harris isn't leaving, and that should alarm us. This book tells the story of the real Kamala Harris, the hilarious, incompetent, trailblazing radical who is now our vice president. It will examine in detail her disastrous and comical first years as vice president. It will investigate how and why staff fled her office and why Democrats lost faith in her leadership without publicly admitting it. It will explore what Harris believes and chronicle her willingness to say anything to prove herself to the hard left by approving and adopting some of their most radical ideas. The book will chronicle her impatient journey into national politics and her disastrous presidential campaign. It will look at why Joe Biden selected her as his running mate in 2020, including how her allies worked behind the scenes to disparage other candidates until Harris looked like the best choice by comparison. It will look back at how Harris began as a prosecutor and moved into local San Francisco politics and high society after dating California State Assembly Speaker Willie Brown. It will reveal how she positioned herself carefully as a politician in California, threading her social connections, her personal biography, and law enforcement record to rise quickly in state politics until she became a United States Senator and ultimately Vice President of the United States. Chapter 1. That Girl Was Me. My mother used to. She would give us a hard time sometimes, and she would say to us, "I don't know what's wrong with you young people. You think you just fell out of a coconut tree?" Kamala Harris, May 10th, 2023. Kamala Iyer Harris was born October 20th, 1964. 2 weeks later, her parents filed an affidavit to change her middle name from Iyer to Devi, the name of a powerful Hindu goddess. Harris's identity was already shifting to better position herself for success. It's unclear why her parents changed her name, but Harris's mother had a deep appreciation for Hindu goddesses. The name Kamala also means lotus flower in Sanskrit. I learned at that, you know, this flower sits on top of the water, but its roots are grounded in the mud, Harris explained later in life. Kamala is also another name for the Hindu goddess Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, fortune, power, beauty, fertility, and prosperity. Her parents were already expecting big things from their daughter. One of Harris's favorite quotes that she shares in interviews is from her mother. "My mother used to say, you don't let people tell them who you are. You tell them who you are," Harris repeats. The way Harris likes to tell it, she was conceived in the civil rights movement and born into the fight for justice. From her earliest days as a politician, Harris introduces herself to audiences, telling the story of her parents as young, idealistic students at the University of California, Berkeley. They fell in love in that most American way, while marching together for justice during the civil rights movement in the 1960s, she wrote in her 2019 memoir, The Truths We Hold. It was a common refrain from her political stump speech. But Donald Harris and Shyamala Gopalan were more cerebral intellectuals than active community organizers. Politicians frequently try to write their own stories and shape their early narratives as they reveal their preferred versions of themselves to the public. For decades, Harris has repeated that she grew up in the civil rights movement, marching and shouting for justice, and shares a version of a story recalling that as a child, she fell out of a stroller while her parents were marching at a civil rights protest with her. The adults kept marching on until they realized she was missing. When they returned, little Kamala was mad. "My mother tells a story about how I'm fussing," Harris says, and she's like, "Baby, what do you want? What do you need?" And I just looked at her and I said, "Freedom." Harris claims her mother told her that story, a version she shared with Elle magazine in April 2021. It's a cute vignette, but it has sparked some healthy skepticism about its origin. The similarities of her stroller story and a story about a child told by civil rights legend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. prompted some accusations of plagiarism. Read this too perfect Kamala Harris story. Then click on this 1965 Alex Haley interview with MLK and search for the word freedom. Free Press editor Barry Weiss wrote on Twitter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.